is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good night and welcome to The Doctor's Inn with me, Dr. Dinothra Archer-Cartwright. I'm a family medicine specialist, and we like to talk about on these Tuesday nights everything pertaining to health, wellness, and things that pertain to the Bahamian society, social topics, as well as health. And so tonight, I want to thank you all for joining us this evening. We have a really interesting show, and we do have a guest. I hope you're going to enjoy this. Tonight we have, he was kind of like my neighbor in the building, but I hardly saw him because he's so busy, right? But I knew he was there. But he moved out next door. But this is an awesome chance for me to, you know, get to know him a little bit better and for the world to hear him talk about this really interesting topic. We're going to talk tonight about colon cancer. It's something you always hear about. You're always told you need to get checked, you need to get screened, but we're going to really get into it and see what do you need to know as a patient, as an individual, when it comes to colon cancer. Before we jump into that, you know, tonight, you know, of course, brought to you by Medical Concierge Services for all your medical healthcare needs. We are both a clinic and a concierge service. So if you need us, 326-1521. We're in Collins Avenue in the Bahamas Heart Center. Check us out on Facebook and Instagram. So tonight we're on also Guardian Talk Radio. You can catch us live there, as well as The Doctor's Inn with me, Dr. D. Archer. So I want him to talk a little bit about himself, but I'm going to introduce him. We have with us tonight Dr. Wesley Francis, who's a surgical oncologist. So welcome to the show.
Thank you, Dr. Archer, for finally, finally we get a chance to sit down and have a chat. Like you said, we were neighbors for such a long period of time, and we hardly ever saw each other. Thank you for this opportunity to come on to share with your listenership about something that's near and dear to my heart and something that affects our community, and that's colon cancer.
So before we jump right into it, I want everybody to explain to them, what is a surgical oncologist? What is it that you really do?
Okay, so I'm a, so what's a surgical oncologist? It's basically a surgeon that is subspecialized in oncology. And oncology is as what are you required to be called a surgical oncologist? Well, first of all, you have to do a surgical residency where you go through and you become a general surgeon. And once you've completed that, and that usually takes about 5 years, and this is post-medical school. And once you completed that, then you go ahead and you work in a cancer center. And the surgical oncology fellowships range anywhere from 2 to 3 years. And at the end of that 2 to 3 years, then you're given this title as surgical oncologist. And what it is really is that you work in what I call a multidisciplinary environment. You work in a cancer center, but you don't work. You're working with radiation oncologists. You're working with medical oncologists. And the whole idea is to be able to typically in a manner where you have a team approach. And so that is what the training is about. Yes, you also get to operate on basically all different cancers, different cancer sites. it's colon, breast, liver, pancreas. You get exposure to all of those things. But I think what really makes the difference is to be able to work with colleagues from other disciplines, and that's from radiation oncology, medical oncology, and come together to basically try to achieve the best outcome for patients. And then that's the kind of learning environment and working environment that a surgical oncologist functions in.
So I hope you guys get that. He is like a specialist of specialists. He did all the training plus some more and then plus some extra. And Dr. Francis does. Now, colon cancer, is that a problem in the Bahamas?
Well, yes, it is a problem in the Bahamas. And so colon cancer would, if you look at our registry, would be the third most common cancer in the Bahamas. Now, that's breast, prostate, and then colon to follow, right? We know that breast gets a lot of press. And, you know, prostate cancer is ongoing. And although, you know, the men complain because their group is called us too, just because sometimes we forget that men get prostate cancer. We focus a whole lot on breast. But then colon cancer, I sometimes call the orphan child, and we forget about it. But really, it can cause the most morbidity or problems for patients. And it's something that's totally preventable. So when you look at men and women, though, so for men and women, it would be the second most common. So overall, it's the third.
Right.
And for women and men, it's the second most common. And again,
I think that's, before you go on, I think that's a really key point, because for some reason, we kind of lump colon cancer in with prostate, like men. We don't think about women with colon cancer. And that's really what brings it up into the second place, because when you're looking overall, both men and women, because you have women having breast, you've got men having prostate, but this is a cancer that's pretty high up there that affects both populations.
Yeah, it affects both men and women, and to a significant degree. And again, it's totally preventable. You know, I always say you can't really, right? Well, you can, but to prevent breast cancer, a woman would have to remove her breasts, right? And even then, it's really just a risk reduction. But colon cancer, so what we focus on in breast cancer and in prostate cancer is early detection.
Yes.
Because we can't really prevent it, okay? But colon cancer, it's something that can be prevented, because the majority of colon cancer arise from what we call polyps. And polyps are growths within the colon that are non-cancerous or benign. And if they can be detected early on and removed, then that would prevent colon cancer. So if you think about it, there's a continuum where these polyps over a period of time, and there's a significant lead time, because it's up to 8 to 10 years before a polyp matures to become colon cancer. So you think about the lead time that you have there. In that period of time, you could actually, if it is that you could remove the polyp, then it is that you could prevent someone from getting colon cancer.
Yeah, I love this idea of prevention. You know, I'm all about prevention, Dr. Francis. What are some of the things that could help or would lead to polyps?
Well, here's the thing, and I'm sure this is something that you probably try to educate your patients, your listenership. There's this concept of the Western diet, right? Because there's been some trials in the past where they look at, let's say they take somebody out of Africa and or siblings, and you have one, put them in the West and leave the other in Africa, colon cancer, and there was who would have moved to the West. And so I think what they extrapolated from that, it had to be in the diet. And so this Western diet, where you have more refined carbohydrates, more meat, red meat related. So these are some of the things that diet related that we say lead to or may have some correlation or causation of colon cancer. Now, I can be honest, I've seen some vegetarians who have colon cancer, right?
Exactly.
So it's not, I mean, that, and I'm not saying to the listenership, oh, go out there and stop eating meat altogether.
Yeah. I always believe in moderation, small cuts of meat and high quality meat. I think we also have a problem with where we're sourcing some of this food is a factor.
Your body, right? And obviously if you consume so much of that, then it can lead to the development. But I think one of the significant factors in the development of colon cancer really is genetics. Mm-hmm. And some people are predisposed to developing polyps for different reasons, for what there are variations, a number of mutations that can occur that makes you more susceptible to developing polyps even at an earlier age. And sometimes, and these are people sometimes you can't catch because they're outside of the screening age. But if it is that they have a family history, then and again, I always say that people have to have a relationship with their primary care physician, because I think that's when you have to when your family physician knows your family and takes your entire history, and then they can pretty much individualize the screening for you. So, for example, if you're a young person and other people in your family at a young age would have
had
cancer and stuff like that, then somebody would have picked that up and realized, look, something's going on here. And therefore, let's try to see if we could intervene and perform some mitigation factors and perhaps screen even outside of the normal screening age.
Yes.
So, having that relationship, I think, with your primary care physician is what's more important. And that's what individualized medicine is about.
Yeah, I think, you know, continuity of care is a big part of that as well, to not fall through the gaps. So, really, like you said, forming that relationship with your primary care doctor, and just like keeping that bond going for a while so that they're aware of changes. They are aware of your family to do more individualized care for patients who may be at risk.
Yeah, I mean, that's important because it's only then that you can identify changes. And it's an annual visit, just once a year. It takes more time to go and service your car a couple times a year than to service your one body that you have. And so that annual physical with a competent primary care physician who knows you, who understands the relationship and can monitor your trend over time. And that's what's important, as you said, the continuity of care. So colon cancer, like I said, it's again, dietary related. Every alcohol in excess has caused all kind of problems, right?
It's like smoking. It's all over the place.
I mean, that's just something that we're taught. But I think it's all related. And it's about, I think people have to have a sense of maintenance, health maintenance, mm-hmm. and not abusing the one body that you have.
I find that Bahamians too, we tend to be on the extremes of things sometimes. If they go hard on something, they go very hard. So alcohol, if you're a smoker, those things, we have two extremes where people won't put anything in their body. And then we have another extreme where people are really abusing and increasing their risks.
And then things like sedentary lifestyle too. I mean, exercise does actually help.
Yeah.
And then if you have, would predispose you to development, but you would know if you had those conditions, right? Like inflammatory bowel disease, Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis. Those are the things that you would know from, you are that puts you at a higher risk. And again, your family physician would know this. And then, you know, be able to then advise you in an appropriate manner to when to get screened. So in general, you know, and so that's why it's important. Again, this is a preventable disease. Yes. Now, I see a lot of colon cancer, but right. I don't need to see all of them, right? Because if it is that we could screen people, and currently the screening age is 45, and it used to be 50, but it's been brought down, especially African descent, because we tend to, what they've noticed is we tend to get colon cancer earlier. And again, this is what we call sporadic, meaning, you know, there's genetic related and right. then there's sporadic. And the sporadic is what we believe is so much more related to the dietary habits.
Right. So it's less so maybe just like Black as race, but Black as in right. habits. Because yes. you did mention the Africans are going to have less, but in Western society, perhaps Blacks have a poor diet for different reasons, cultural reasons, perhaps. And that's something that you can really focus on when it comes to looking at that at-risk population.
Well, yeah. And again, there's health promotion, at-risk people. And so I think you got to start early. Early, and when I say early, early from in school.
Childhood, yeah.
You know what I mean? And educate people, because I think, you know, education, believe it or not, is one of the most important things that we can do, or what I would call interventions that we can do that'll change people's health.
Yeah, we talk about that quite a lot on the show, implementing a lot of these health initiatives in the children, because you want to change that generation. I mean, it's difficult when people, you know, by the time if they have to be seen by you, it's probably, you know, they have some things going on. And so if we're going to have a change in the future, you definitely have to start with the children and start the initiatives there, the education there, because it's a lot of health related and diet, sedentary lifestyle, all of those things. You know, culturally, we've seen that we're bigger people in terms of weight. You know, we're very late on.
I confirmed that in Parliament the other day, right? So, but you see, that's a problem that you're not going to fix overnight.
Right.
And it's going to take educating the children. And believe me, if you educate children, then that'll even it get into adult too. Because I mean, if you have a school program, I totally understand. I mean, some people may not be able to afford it, and hence social services may be able to help and stuff. But if you have a school program that looks at healthy diets within the school, that's eventually going to trickle over into home.
Yes.
Because people have to provide that. And listen, parents eat what their children eat a lot of times, you know?
A lot of times. And we have a lot of households led by the kids, right? So the kids wanted this, so we went and got that. The kids, da, 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 da. And you also have homes where, you know, the kids are like, I'm not eating that particular thing. So the parents actually... A lot of times we bend to the kids because we want to have them eating. We want them to be happy about whatever they're eating. And so the power is with the children. I mean.
Yeah, if you have kids that eat healthy, trust me, parents are going to be healthy. If you have kids that are very active, parents are going to be very active too. So education stems across generations. And it's one of the things that are very cheap. You know, is a cheap intervention, and it'll help and prevent some of these downstream issues, because I feel a lot of times that we're especially somebody like me, I'm at the end of the river picking up these bodies, right? Mm-hmm. And everything is happening upstream,
right?
Education, you know, ensuring people see their primary care doctors. And again, if you have an educated populace, they will seek the care that they need. They will look at the proper nutrition that they need. They will avoid these toxic behaviors. They will try to exercise. So education goes far. And I think a lot of those school programs, that I don't know if we still have them, but certainly that's an initiative that could help. These things take time. You can't change them overnight.
No. We have to approach things, like education and programs for people who are older, who may already have some chronic disease. And then you have prevention for young people. And then you do need like a really kind of strong educational program for young children so that you actually are developing the type of behaviors that you want to see in the future. I think a big problem we have here is we haven't determined what we want Bahamas to look like in 10 years or 20 years. We talk about the problems, but we don't then say, okay, in 10 years, we want everybody to have a normal BMI. How would you accomplish that? You would then have to go through the steps of what that takes, right? And that's where you would start saying, well, hey, we have to target the kids in primary school, because in 10 years, they're going to be adults. We have to target the young adults who are X, Y, and Z. And then these people who we know are very at risk because of their behavior, we have to have like a strong program and incentives to get them to reverse some of the things that we're doing. So lots of work.
Yeah, if you remember, I mean, and I know we're talking about colon as a disease, right? But remember when we first went to medical school, at least I remember this, like the first set of classes that we had was community health, right? And they talked about the natural history of disease. And, you know, in every natural history of disease, there's a period where you're asymptomatic, you have no issue. Then there's a period where you become at risk. And then there's a period where you become symptomatic. And then they also showed how you can intervene with disease. And you can intervene at the asymptomatic phase. You can intervene at when people are at risk early, and then when they are symptomatic. And this, the whole primary prevention, secondary prevention, promotion, and again, that's all the education and all of that. And so, again, I think sometimes we go back to first principle, right?
Basics.
So it's the basics that's gonna. And the basics don't cost a lot of money. Right? It just takes an understanding of the principle and the will. Well, the vision to know what would we like to end up with, as you were saying, right? And then we put the necessary processes in place, programs and processes in place to try and achieve that. And then we reward small wins. Yes. And then that just feeds on it. And then we get to the point where we can see a significant change at the end of the road.
And of course, having the policies of the countries linked to all of this, because I do see a lot of times that we talk about health in the country and is that kind of would erode some of that for coming from maybe a different area. And you're just like, are they talking to each other? And so, having that kind of collaborative effort in all aspects.
It's an alignment, right? They got to align primary health care with, and there's a budget for primary health care, there's a budget for secondary health care. But I mean, sometimes if we put enough money into primary health care, then less. I'm not saying we don't put money into secondary.
Yeah, for sure.
You need it because those.
But then you could use your secondary care money more efficiently.
Right. Right. I believe that. So when I think about colon cancer, and I know I'm a surgeon, I like to operate and all of that. But I think the way you make real significant impact is not with my knife, right? It's with education. It's with putting for people to have access to care. Because without access, you can't ever get a good outcome, right? You can't even speak about income unless you have access, and unless you have an education is going to be very important for that. So making sure that kids are, you know, have access to healthy meals in the school, in the home, and overall. And so I think that that's where we need to start with this discussion. Where primary health care is the driver. Because what I do, I mean, yes, I know what I do is important, right?
Yes.
And we'll talk about what I do. But if it is that we could prevent people from getting to where I am, to where they see me, not that I'm trying to put myself out of whatever.
Right. But no, you're there. You're there. Right. If it's if it's needed, yeah. Be right. You're going to do your job. You're there.
Yes.
But of course, as a doctor, you want to see as many recognize. People who don't need to be in that situation.
Yeah.
Not in that situation, because you know you'll always need a surgical oncologist, because you know there are some things you can't stop, but you have the country and the people's interests at heart.
Yeah, prevention is always better than cure. And we spend less on preventative measures than we do on curative measures. You want to look at a healthcare budget and you want to blow it, look at curative measures, right? But if you could focus on preventative measures, and again, like you said, it goes hand in hand, right?
Yes.
Because we have a set of people in the community who are already affected by this, and we got to take them through. So let's talk about colonoscopies a little bit there, right? And screening for colon cancer. And like you said, we had
35.
Right. So, I mean, they have different methods to screening. The gold standard is to do a colonoscopy. And I'm sure this month over the airway, I'm talking about colonoscopies. And it's the optical colonoscope where you undergo sedation, and the physician or the surgeon pass the scope and identify these polyps. And remember, the thing about this is that polyps give you a lead time. And if you remove those polyps while they are benign and not malignant, then end of story. Okay? And I think that's where we'd like to see most people. And again, that's screening. That's people who are asymptomatic. So usually at that phase, you're not complaining of anything. You have no problems. You have no symptoms.
Typical screening. Your doctor recommended go get your colonoscopy. You did.
Right. And so but you got to get it checked out. Now, there are some people who have symptoms now, and they would have gone beyond that screening phase. And what are some of the symptoms of colon cancer? Well, if you see blood in your stool, it's not normal.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If you're an older person, you see blood in your stool, don't just assume that it's hemorrhoids. Because that's one of the things that we always... That's a pitfall, because hemorrhoids do bleed.
Yeah.
They do. But if you're older than 45 and you have some bleeding, let's not make that assumption that it's hemorrhoid. That needs to get checked out. This whole gas pain story that we use. Yeah? Gas pain is almost similar to change in bowel habit. Right? So if it is that you have a problem on the left side of your colon, and you know, all of us, we are regular in our own way.
Mm-hmm.
Some may go once a day, some go once every 2 days, some may go once a week, but that's regular for you. And this is a part of health maintenance, is you got to know what you are, what's normal for you. And when you see you having change in your bowel habits, that's by definition what's abnormal for you. And so if you see periods of constipation and diarrhea, then that becomes symptomatic. And that's something that colon cancer, that's one of the early signs of colon cancer. And then anemia. Sometimes people don't have any symptoms related to change in bowel habits or anything like that, but it is that they're just, the blood count is a bit low, and sometimes it's very subtle.
Mm-hmm.
And that's commonly how right-sided colon cancer presents, because, you know, the masses can grow large on the right side of the colon. But what happens is you're just bleeding slowly, and that causes your blood count to drop. And again, if you're seeing your family doctor and you have an annual physical, you get that blood count, they'll notice, well, you know what? You were 13, you're about 11. Right. Let's check that out. And that's how sometimes we discover colon cancer in patients. And these are people who are well. You may have a little fatigue. So sometimes it's very subtle signs.
Well, yeah, I think those are all very important because people can really kind of be blindsided by it just by missing the subtleties. A lot of people have gone, even with this whole idea of the pandemic, you know, I'm seeing people who haven't had an annual since 2020, 2021. So they skipped a year or two. And you're starting to notice, well, you know, when I saw you, everything was looking okay. Now these little subtle changes that are happening, and we have heard in the news about, you know, there is an increase in cancer that I've, and maybe a lot of this has to do with the fact that some people just haven't been to the doctor in the last few years.
Well, I could tell you, because I'm affiliated with the cancer registry. We've seen this with breast cancer, where, you know, if you look at the incidence of breast cancer, okay, and colon, and I happen to have the numbers in front of me, you would notice that in 2020 and 2021, the numbers went down. And you can say, oh, we're doing better. No, we ain't doing better because we didn't really screen. And especially with breast cancer, if you look at the registry data, 2020 and 2021, the number of breast cancers went down. And again, that's because during that period of time, and I could tell you for a fact that colonoscopies was not being done during the whole COVID pandemic. I mean, yes, when we had lockdowns, we had different priorities. We were taking care of real sick people, not someone to come to get a screening colonoscopy. And that's in the private and the public sector. And that was seen worldwide. So now as we're trying to see this resurgence, but it's really not the resurgence, it's because we didn't screen for about 2 years, right?
So literally all those people are packing in and coming now, and some of them may be even symptomatic.
So yeah, and so what you saw also, what we're seeing is a stage migration where they would have been earlier because of the 2 years lag, they're a little more advanced. And that's the reality. That's what we're seeing. And so I see patients come in the office and you say, okay, when last you had your mammogram, it would have been 2 years, they haven't had one. Or someone who would have met the criteria for screening, but they just didn't see a doctor in the last 2 years. So that's an important thing that now we're in a catch-up phase. So we see 2023 data is going to go back up. But that's the registry data right there, you know?
Yeah, that's definitely. And I hope we get to the point where we really analyze this, do more data, and then we use that to then re-educate the population. So they should really be going hard on their PSAs right now to try get people back in for all of this screening, because you also have people who felt, well, you know, I made it 2-3 years, so no contact with the doctor. Do I need to be seen, especially if I don't have a chronic? I don't know how some people were getting medication, but anyway, that's a whole other story. But yeah. Not being seen for such a long time, and I do advocate a lot for people to at least get their physicals done, because that is a really great way of just pinpointing changes over time, having kind of a reference point if you're a young individual. And so that's it. Are there any other behaviors that could be linked to colon cancer other than diet?
Well, again, as we had said, diet is very important. Alcohol, tobacco use, sedentary lifestyle. And again, there are certain diseases that are linked to increase risk of colon cancer. But that's pretty much it for the most part. But we do have this genetic issue. And I mean, we've had patients who, again, present with polyps at an early age. And we have several families actually with genetic syndromes who were diagnosed early. And again, they would be outside of the screening age. So you're talking about people in their 20s, people in their early 30s. I've had several patients in their 30s who end up getting colon cancer, but it's not that they, that's not a sporadic cancer as we talked about. That's more genetic.
Genetic related.
Right. And so, again, paying close attention to your body to know when things are not right, to having those symptoms, blood in your stool, that's a key thing. That's not normal. Nobody should ever think that seeing blood in their stool is normal. And certainly this persistent change in your bowel habits, that's something that you need to really get checked out. And then there's the extremes, right? Then we have patients who come in blocked when we have to do emergency surgery. And I would say emergency surgery, it's surgery to take care of the emergency. And emergency surgery doesn't do well for cancers per se. It's best to take care of cancers in a non-emergent setting.
Yeah.
Because the outcomes are far so much better when we take care of things, what we call electively, where you would have had the diagnosis and then your treatments are planned. And so in terms of treatment for colon cancer, I mean, surgery is the gold standard. And again, colon cancer, even if you get it, can be cured.
What's the right now? How well are we doing? I know over time with new techniques, we tend to get better and better. How well are we doing with?
So survival rates really depend on the stage. Okay, so you know stage 1, 2, 3, 4. So obviously, if you come with stage 1 or stage 2 colon cancers, and that means it is confined to the colon itself. It has not spread to what we call the lymph nodes. Then you're like, your survival is above 90% in those situations. When you start to have spread beyond the colon, then you see that survival rate starts to taper. And those patients require chemotherapy, and that improves their survival. So chemotherapy, and again, I mean, chemotherapy always gets a bad rep, but chemotherapy is very helpful in situations like that when you have stage 3 or stage 4 colon cancer. And the chemotherapeutic agents have gotten so much better. This stuff is available in the Bahamas. Mm-hmm. We have what is called targeted therapy, where there's certain targets within the cell that are attacked. And so, you know, the side effects are less. And again, technology has gotten so much better. But what's important is, again, if you get it, you want to hope that you're at an early stage.
Right. And that's where prevention is key.
Right. And in fact, if you're at an early stage, mm-hmm. you may not even need chemotherapy. People with stage 1 and stage 2 colon cancer, surgery alone is curative.
Awesome.
Okay, and you will not need any chemotherapy, but when you get to stage 3, you definitely do need, because it is in those subset of patients that is beneficial. The one thing I gotta address here, because everybody they don't like the dreaded bag, you know. So if you have an elective or a routine surgery for colon cancer, you will not get a bag. The bag is usually within when there's an emergency situation. And let me tell you, bags save people's lives. It's often temporary. It can be reversed. So the whole dreaded thing about the bag, you have people who giving them a bag in a situation where they come in an emergency situation saves their lives.
So that, I think because people want to know that. They do see these things. They think that's a routine thing, perhaps. You know, patients talk all this different information. They don't really relate the medical aspect of it or how it really all happened. I think an important point that you mentioned was in the early stages, you have such a high rate of survival because a lot of people feel, you know, do I really want to know this? Like, am I going to survive? Am I, you know, chemo and all of this stuff like that? Whereas with all the technology there is and the advancements in techniques, it may be, I wouldn't say a simple surgery, but a surgery where they can move on fairly quickly with their life.
But yeah, certainly. And so not only has surgery evolved, the medications have evolved, and the support care has also evolved. And all of these, again, and I stress, all of these are available to patients in the Bahamas, in the public and the private sector, right? And we do a fair amount of colon surgery. And like I said, the outcomes are, again, when you're caught early, even in certain situations of stage four. Now, you know, sometimes people think when they get stage four, it's not because, you know, all stage fours aren't the same. And if, in fact, and colon is one of those diseases, if, in fact, that, for example, because how do we define stage four? Stage four just means that it's outside of the colon and it's gone to another organ. Like, for example, the liver or the lung, and the most common one is the liver. And surgery has evolved that we can actually operate on the liver and remove those tumors from the liver. And those people actually get benefit from that and have survival over those who would not have had surgery. And it really depends on the extent of spread within the liver, because the liver is something that we can remove and it kind of grows, regenerates itself. So, and again, all of this has evolved over years. Many years ago, that, you know, that's not something that we would do, but it's something that we do now. And we've found that that it extends survival. So again, it is one of those diseases. One, it's preventable. Two, if you get it and in the early stage, it's curable with surgery alone. If it is that you do need chemotherapy and it's at a stage four level, it can still be treated and it's still potentially curable. So it's not a death sentence in the least bit. All right. But what I like to focus on is the prevention aspect of it, because it can be prevented.
Very true. Let me open the phone lines in case we have someone. I'm sorry, callers. I always get caught into the conversation. But if we do want to, if you do want to join in or you do have a question, 325-4316, 325-4259, and 322-6232. You can join tonight by Dr. Wesley Francis. He's a surgical oncologist. We're talking tonight about colon cancer. You were surmising we have a caller. So, caller, you're on the air.
All right. Yes, good afternoon, Dr. Archer.
Hi, good afternoon.
Good afternoon to the doctor.
Good afternoon.
I always listen to the conversations, but, you know, my mom died from colon cancer. And it was painful. I think she was wearing the proper name. It's the colonoscopy bag. It's called an
colostomy
bag.
Yeah, the colostomy.
Colostomy bag. Yeah, and I used to change it. And what I would notice is that the stool would be fresher after the surgery because she didn't have to go through the rectum. But the colon is just an extension of the rectum, right?
Well, the rectum is an extension.
It's an extension of the colon.
Yeah. And what it means is that what are the advantages of the colon being clean and being kept empty and being peristalsis and speeding up versus the fecal matter just sitting in the colon, right? And the poor diet, because I remember there was a cousin of mine, she was only about 20 years old, and she had polyps, right? And I saw that it was as a result of an impoverished diet. But I got a little awakening just now when you said that you saw cancer in, or you saw polyps in vegetarians, right? So what is the data on that? And like, were they had a cross diet, or how long were they vegetarians? They never took that into consideration, because my mom had the colon cancer, and I really, I was one of these people who checked myself, you know, like within a few minutes when I get up, I would have a pass. And so I wouldn't go anywhere unless I passed, because I know my movement, and I check the fecal, I check it for, like, you know, I know what is poor quality. And so I was just wondering, what are the advantages of keeping clean to buffer against this? Because I realize that some diseases are not contagious, but they are transmissible through genetics. They have done these studies long time. But I don't, being that they say the colonoscopy is invasive, you know, I really don't think, I don't think I should be doing it every so often.
So here's a couple of things. Let's start off with the polyp situation in the 20-year-old, right?
Yes.
So we that's something that is rarely seen. And that's, and
well, when you see that, poor diet, how to?
No. It's not,
listen,
not
to M50,
related to diet. It's usually people who have some sort of predisposition, some genetic mutation that leads to that development. Okay? That's usually not a diet-related situation. When we start to see, so if you divide colon cancer, you can look into genetic-related ones and what we call sporadic. Usually is a disease of older age. And that you see that around age 50s, 60s or so.
So what are the ways to avoid it? I mean, high fiber, because you're saying genetics, there's no, so that means I should be getting screened because I'm kind of cocky, or that's what I'm saying is I...
I
stopped eating meat for like 20 years.
I don't know how old you are, but if you are if you are 45 years or older, you should have been screened.
Yeah. And then he's also saying, you know, his mom had this, so there may be...
But my movements are normal, like three times a day. Like if I eat three times a day, I pass.
A genetic component, environmental, but it...
Remember what we said, right? When you have polyps, you're totally asymptomatic. You have no symptoms whatsoever. Your movements would be normal, and it's only until that polyp, which there's a significant lead time, sometimes 8 to 10 years, for that then to develop a problem within the colon.
So, doc, is there any way to bypass, just because you get a stool check, is there any way to check for cancer from the fecal matter?
So there is a new test that is out now. It's called a FIT test, right?
All right. I'll hang up and listen.
So one of the things that's out there is, and I don't think it's here, because, I mean, you probably go on TV and hear, but it's Cologuard, right? And it's a FIT. It's a DNA test. And what happens is that's a test that can detect or gives a higher indication that there's a possibility of polyps within the colon. And some people are using that now as a screen. And if that's positive, then you can go ahead and then do a colonoscopy, right? And there's some other tests too, which we do have available, which is a Guaiac test, where it tests blood in your stool. I didn't know, because again, the colon, it's a long organ. It has right side, and then it goes across, called transverse colon, and then the descending colon. And the right side of the colon mainly, it takes out the water out of the stool. And it's larger than the left side. The left side is much narrower and has a storage capacity. And so when you have tumors on the right side of your colon, they can grow large and cause to have no symptoms other than the fact that you would have been bleeding within the stool.
Just a little bit.
And that's how those stool tests, so the caller talked about stool tests. But then again, that's, at that point, you're symptomatic.
Exactly.
Okay. And so this is why we try to encourage people. We don't want you when you're symptomatic. Because when you're symptomatic, then, you know, you have some, the likelihood of you having a disease is high. We want you in that asymptomatic phase, and that's when we can screen. So screening, you don't screen people who have symptoms.
Exactly.
Your screening is for people who don't have symptoms. So if you, if you're
hopefully to catch something early before right. it's something that can't be treated the way that you have good outcomes.
So if the caller is a guy who is 45 or over 45 and he has normal bowel function and everything, and hey, everything percolating, okay, you're the guy.
The
person for screening. When you start having problems, you're not getting screening no more. That's when we call it diagnosis. We're trying to make a diagnosis. And again, like I said, this is preventable. If you find a polyp, then certainly you remove it. You prevent colon cancer.
I will tell you guys all my business. I've had a colonoscopy, and to get it done because they think it's like this, you know, this thing. It's so I don't know. It's weird that I enjoyed my colonoscopy. Right? It's weird that I enjoyed my colonoscopy. I had a good sleep. I woke up. There was like, Dr. Archie, you need to leave now. And I was like, oh, this is great. I didn't feel anything. I don't remember anything. I don't remember anything. No. I knew they put me to sleep. And then I woke up and I was feeling great. And that was it.
The worst part of a colonoscopy, and I tell patients this all the time, because I do colonoscopies also, it's the prep, because you got to clean up your colon. And again, you know, the caller alluded to, you know, keeping the colon clean. You know, a high fiber diet is a good.
That's what I think he was alluding right. to, you know, yes. this high fiber diet of keeping your colon like as clean and right. having a good normal pass all the time. Yes. That's helpful and stop the polyps.
That's all meant for. And again, we're looking at the Africans versus the people in the Western, because the African diet is higher in fiber, complex carbohydrates, not this refined stuff that we have in this part of the world. And so that's why there's a correlation. Now, I mean, I don't think that there's anybody's proven causation, but there's correlation and there's causation. You more likely, you know, your diet is what's more than likely causing you or related to you developing these polyps and later on developing cancer. And so high fiber diet is important. Complex carbohydrates is important. Going back to the ground provisions, you know, stuff that comes out of the ground, those are more complex carbohydrates and they tend to have much more fiber in it than these refined stuff that you mm-hmm. get out of a box.
And just run through and cause right. havoc.
Right. So again, diet is very important with respect mm-hmm. to this. But we cannot forget, though, it's not diet related at all. It's because of genetics. And family history is important. The only way we can get a clue that you may have genetic related is if it occurs in your family. And sometimes people with mutation, they're the first person that expressed that mutation. Wow. So even though, and I've seen that, so even though they have a mutation, the rest of the family sometimes is spared, and then that person has the mutation and the expression of that, and they get polyps early and they have problems. I have a couple of patients who fit that category. Any other callers? That was a good
Yeah, we don't even have time for another caller almost.
Oh, really?
We've got like 3 minutes left, right? Wow. The time flies on this show, Dr.
We just was talking. I feel like we were just talking.
Exactly. Everybody comes and they're like, oh, when am I going to talk and fill all the time up? But the time goes very quickly when we're having a good conversation, when we're providing this type of information and doing all of that. So in the last few minutes, I want you to just kind of say what you want to say to the public and summarize what you really want people to get out of what we talked about today. What are those key points that you want to stress so that people are aware of how important this topic is?
So what I would like to say emphasizes health maintenance and how health awareness and health maintenance. Be aware of your body. Be aware of the things that you put inside your body. And also maintain health as you go along. you have one body. And what's important is that if we pick up disease early on in its onset, we have so much options for treatment. But colon cancer is one of those things that can be totally prevented. And again, screening is important. We would like to get you screened when you're asymptomatic and you're not having symptoms. And then also catch you at an early stage, because your outcome with treatment, and whether that treatment is surgery, chemotherapy, whatever, your outcomes will be better and you would have a better quality of life. But ultimately, healthy living, healthy lifestyle, watching your diet, making sure you have a good primary care physician, and annually check your annual checks with the same person, because then trends and that developing that relationship, I think, is what is more important than anything. And shopping around, to me, doesn't make any sense. You find someone who's good, you stick with that person. That person understands when at certain points in your life that you need to be screened, and that what needs to be done.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. And I'm glad you say you do the colonoscopy, so they can meet you earlier rather than later. So yeah. You're both on the preventative side, and you're also doing the surgeries as well. Do you mind dropping the name of your clinic?
Well, I'm in Centerville Medical Center. It's called Cancer Surgery Bahamas. And again, I'm a surgical oncologist. That's what I do. That's why we call it Cancer Surgery Bahamas. We take care of cancers.
Right. Excellent. I want to thank you. The time is just gone, but I want to thank you, Dr. Francis, Wesley Francis, for joining me tonight and, you know, just imparting such important information to the Bahamian public, and allowing them to just be aware of kind of like that silent third guy, colon cancer, the entire community. You're welcome anytime on The Doctor Is In. So hopefully
we'll have a
chance to talk a little bit more and cover some of these other topics as we bring the Bahamian people back into the healthcare system. We want the best for them. And we want to thank everybody for listening tonight, brought to you by Medical Concierge Services. We are here every Tuesday on Guardian Radio on The Doctor Is In with me, Dr. D. Good night.
All right. Good night.
FM, Nassau, Bahamas.